Penguin Trooper, by the way.
Penguin Trooper.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, I just got a notification to say that we should watch episode 24, Radio Style of the Podcast, in real time. My phone's all about letting me know when I'm broadcasting shit and that I should watch it. All right, so keep trying to adjust my badge. I think I spend too much time at conventions. So we have kind of a full house tonight. So we have with us Root Squared. Are we
square,
ever going to see Square Root?
We're Square Root. Are we ever going to see what?
Your beautiful face. Do you have a webcam?
I do have a webcam. I am in my room, and my room is a mess. So
I mean, have you seen my office? Just look at this crappy. Like, look at this. Look at this.
No. That's different. That's your office speech. This is my bedroom. This is my lair of privacy.
Oh, okay. So you've got dirty underwear hanging off the lamp.
No, actually, I don't. But it's more like you don't expose that private part of yourself.
Well, that's
just like
I
you
just,
don't
yeah,
run down
like
the street.
That's why I just had the camera
with your wang hanging out. Yeah, just zoom way in. I'll just turn the camera on and just have it focused right on my eye.
There you go.
Unsettling at all.
Hey, all right. We also have with us Johnny Christmas.
Yep.
I believe it was Penguin Trooper.
Hey, what's up? From Europe.
Oh, wow.
We have Night Owl and, as always, Beaches. And welcome to the 24th podcast. So it's been legitimately like 2 years since we've started doing these things.
That's crazy.
And a lot has changed in 2 years, including the fact that this is going to be our last podcast using Hangouts on Air.
Wow.
And it's not by choice, it's because Google is sunsetting Hangouts on Air on the 12th of September.
Ooh.
Which is sadly after or before the next podcast. So, I have some other ideas, but we're going to have to use, in the next month, we're going to have to do some dry runs to make sure everything's going to work. But I have some ideas around it, and we still should be able to use YouTube to do it, which will be good. All right, so who all has been keeping up with the news?
I've been trying to, very badly.
Not me.
Give me a moment to
try not to
sort something out. Let's see.
Just vaguely. Yeah.
Okay, how about this? This might have happened.
Interesting news stories? Was that a weird way of asking for that?
No, I mean, I had some stuff that I had read.
You wanted to make
recently,
sure we were familiar
but
with it.
No, I wanted to
well,
see if anybody had
something.
Do what?
Well, since our last podcast, there's been some interesting stuff going on with some supposedly leaked NSA tools.
Oh, yeah.
And apparently, just today, I'm still trying to make it through the story, but there's a story out from TechDirt, which seems to be saying that the leaked NSA Zero Days are now actually possibly being exploited in the wild.
I've been doing it, so yes.
Okay, well, there we go. We have firsthand confirmation. But
yeah.
The link's there in the chat.
Some of the ASA ones to work, and like best I've been able to do is like I can get them to crash the ASAs, but they don't like pull back the credits that they were supposed to. So like there was a problem. A lot of those, everything in that dump was from I think like prior to 2012. So,
I thought 2013 was the last timestamp on something like that.
A lot of stuff in it has long since been patched or only applies to very end-of-life software or firmware version. And that's not to say that stuff's not still out there. I come across 10-year-old equipment all the time.
Sure.
It's not as devastating of a leak as if it had, in fact, happened in 2012.
Right. I thought I saw something with the exploits for Fortinet still being viable against their more current products.
Yeah, you did see that, and I work for a Fortinet shop and we did send requests off to them, like, hey, what are we doing about this? And I don't recall getting a response, although I may not have been included on that response, so don't use my statement as authoritative.
Oh, well. Yeah, I just recalled seeing a few people who were going through some of the raw dumps and trying to make sense of them, and they were reaching out to Fortinet through Twitter, which was always amusing to see. But, you know, real-time back and forth between the researcher and the company out in the public there.
Oof.
But, you know, Fortinet at least seemed like they were honestly trying to get a grasp on the situation. But, let's see. This particular story, a researcher at NYU, Brendan Dolan Gavitt, set up a honeypot that was masquerading as a vulnerable system. Looks like he specifically configured it to show itself as being vulnerable to some of the Cisco zero days that were in that dump. And apparently he actually got some people attacking that system within 24 hours using those new exploits.
Oh, wow.
I'm just sort of skimming the article here, so I may be missing some important details, but as usual, TechDirt manages to have a kind of snarky, humorous take on it as well. So I usually find their stuff worth reading. Also, according to the UK Home Ministry, the internet is no longer for porn. It is now for terrorism.
Oh, are we like as in terrorism is now 30% of the internet?
From the way they're trying to spin it, yeah, it looks like they're now trying to claim that Facebook, Twitter, and Google are deliberately assisting terrorists using their websites.
Wait, deliberately assisting?
That, like... their exact words, Facebook, Twitter, and Google are deliberately failing to stop terrorists from using their websites to promote terrorism.
How were you supposed to...
Yeah, I really don't know. I mean, this is one of those things where someone who doesn't understand how computers work decides that, well, since there was one bad person that said a thing on there that one time, the platform must be responsible.
Or, worse yet, they design auto filters or, you know, block entire... because one bad thing was said one time.
Yeah.
I mean, that's already enshrined in English law, so...
Well, here's the thing, too, is that sometimes it's more useful to let them talk about shit and just listen in. Like, if you ban them from Twitter, they're just going to talk on something else.
Right, and
so
I
if
mean,
they're out there in the public talking about shit that is not a wise thing to talk about in public...
Well...
Let them talk and then go.
Yeah,
well,
I mean,
feel like the worry there is like two pronged though, right?
Yeah.
So you've got their active recruitment efforts, and then you've also got their discussing strategy.
And for the most part, discussing strategy doesn't seem to be happening there. So it's not really operational intelligence that we'd be gathering if we allow intelligence agencies allow terrorist groups to continue spreading their propaganda message over various social media networks. On the other hand, for people researching terrorism, attempting to work out ways to counter propaganda from these sorts of groups, having publicly available resources to watch that stuff in real time is actually quite useful.
Yeah.
And, I mean, of course... England does not exactly have the same robust or theoretically robust protection of political and religious speech that U.S. law supposedly has.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. And also that, like, those laws, especially if you're speaking constitutionally, only apply to restrictions in, that the government can enforce.
Well, yes.
They don't say that Facebook must abide by the First Amendment. That's patently untrue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's a certain distinction. So, well, when it comes to, in terms of censorship, you're not wrong that, like, people can remove whatever from their service. I just wanted to make a point that censorship can still be by private parties, and it's still called censorship. It's not governmental only.
Oh, yes. Yeah,
but censorship. They have a right to censor stuff in terms of things private like organizations.
Absolutely. In terms of things like the First Amendment only applies to specific government action, not, and it doesn't even necessarily apply to the government, say, through the form of a court order in support of an application from a private party.
Censorship is a noun with a definition.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It's not a legal thing.
Yeah.
No, it's more that becomes a sort of difficult thing to police in a social scale, not even a legal issue, when we decide that socially, one type of speech is out of bounds. It very quickly becomes easy to start putting more and more things outside of that boundary without necessarily allowing for any sort of critical discussion about it.
Sure. Well, and that's the whole Wild West of the internet. Like, everybody talks about Wild West internet, like, oh, it's free and open for anyone to do anything, and governments shouldn't be involved in restricting that. But just like I think people forget that the Wild West was also ruled by sheriffs who really got to just make up the rules of their town and say what does and does not go. And so that's what we're seeing. And
pretty much.
That's
I mean,
the thing. And yeah, and you can get upset and yell about it, and you can lynch the sheriff. Sure. You can leave town.
But I mean, the other thing is that. Oh, sorry, Johnny.
This is how anarchy works. This is exactly what it is. It's, yeah.
Someone's got a cockatoo.
Whose phone is blowing up?
I think that's you, Beaches. Almost.
That is not me. Mine is on silent.
Okay, because I see you looking down at it every time I hear the sound.
I mean, my phone is. I'm just looking down at it. I'm actually texting my girlfriend, who's in another part of the house. but my phone is definitely on. I have one of these things, and it's all nice and shit because it lets me have my phone on silent and still be able to actually respond to stuff.
Okay.
Well, aren't you fancy?
So that's me, but it's also my messages. My SMS and my computer tweeting is really weird because my computer mic should not be picking that up, or else we'd be getting a crazy feedback loop. So that's
that's weird.
Mm-hmm. It's really not picking this up.
No, it doesn't seem to be. But back to the topic at hand, because we can troubleshoot Johnny's bizarre microphone problem later. Yes, the point I was trying to work towards was that. While we do have in the United States the legal protections of the First Amendment and similar court rulings and laws and so forth, on the internet, big companies, particularly those that control centralized services like a social media network, actually exercise the same or more control than a government could in the real world.
Yes, right.
So, appointing Facebook or Twitter or Google as the arbiter of what is and is not allowable speech on the internet or even just on their own service, while it does meet a legal test, may in fact end up creating the exact type of situation that the First Amendment and similar legal concepts are supposed to prevent on the part of a government in the real world.
And that's exactly what's happening. And the very important difference being that if you don't like what your government is doing, in most cases you do have the option to leave the country, and that's but that is usually an incredibly difficult proposition.
Sure.
Whereas on the internet, you are totally welcome to leave Facebook, and it's incredibly easy.
Yes, or yes, it is certainly...
Or in any way other than your friends are like...
I mean, it just becomes the network effect problem.
Yes.
Well, yeah, I mean, really, in off the wire, basically, the only options you have for loudly expressing an idea are, what, Megaphone? You know, that's probably the most...
Completely. There are plenty of other outlets on the internet where...
No. Well, I mean, without relying
off
on the
wire, not on the internet. So in meat space.
You've got like a Megaphone at best, right?
Posters, stickers. There's other ways.
In my area, person who is now very likely to be my next congressman still campaigns primarily with a flatbed truck with a bunch of PAs on it.
That's
and
awesome.
A Dominican guy screaming his head off into a microphone. You know.
Which most municipalities have laws against.
Honestly, I really wish that someone would actually point out that I'm pretty sure it violates the local municipal code, but that truck specifically actually cost me $350,000.
Was that what caused the leak in your house?
No, that was what caused the real estate purchase that I very much did not want to make. Because I was in the middle of the call negotiating the purchase. Mm. And trying to explain that I was not happy about the property, and everyone there thought that my shouting, "I can't hear a word you're saying, there's this incredibly loud truck following me down the street," somehow meant, "No, I'm totally okay with this purchase. Please, spend my money." But anyway.
Well, I think my entire point I was going there with that is... you have a pretty limited scope of communication in meat space, you know?
Yes.
But on social media, where we don't have these certain rights afforded to us, we have a greater reach by and far, but it's, I guess, the same rights aren't afforded to us. In meat space, you can use media. You've got like the news and whatever, but like it still follows the same sort of pattern where the more reach you get, the more potential restrictions, the less safety, I guess, you're guaranteed.
And it's also the more dependent you are on completely unrelated third parties deliberately decide to promote your message.
Yeah.
I mean, on Twitter right now, if I say something, no matter how brilliant or insanely stupid it is, 1,325 people are likely to see it.
Mm.
And that's assuming that not a single person retweets or links or forwards that tweet that I make. On the other hand, if I were to shout out the exact same thing in the middle of a crowded street, it's however many people, one, are within earshot, two, can actually make out what it is that I'm shouting, and three, decide to not either run away screaming or pummel me.
Right. You're just talking about audience size.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, where do you get the biggest audience? Well, where the most people conglomerate, which is... Facebook, Twitter, Reddit, etc. And so,
even on those platforms, you know, may not be guaranteed the audience size of, say, getting on CNN or a major news network or...
But also your audience size, your audience in general tends to be your demographic for your shouting. Also, and you can argue that, well, I don't want my demographic to hear the shouting. I need the people who shouted at to hear the shouting, not the people who are like me. The people who are like me are already shouting the same thing, which is that whole echo chamber effect. My response to that is that outside of, you know, specific scenarios, shouting is often not going to change those people's minds. You know, you can
typically
agree with
presenting,
that. Yeah.
You can present facts as loudly as you want, but they're going to vote for whomever they've already made up their mind to vote for, etc. And shouting at them just makes them just dislike you more and not want to listen to you. Proving that they're wrong makes them dislike you more and not want to listen to you. You know, you're stuck in that what are you going to do scenario.
I found that in those one-on-one is invaluable, because that's pretty much the only way you're ever going to reliably change someone's opinion or
sure.
perception.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'll sign up for that. We've got Kira talking in the chat over here, who was asking, how do these laws, and I think we're talking about the laws that govern what you are and aren't allowed to talk about online, like how do they affect the users of Facebook as opposed to Reddit? And I think she means, like, given that Facebook is far more restrictive with what it allows you to talk about versus what Reddit allows you to talk about, how do the laws of what you're allowed to talk about online vary? And I think there's confusion there as to, like, the laws aren't limited to specific website. And the laws, as far as US law goes, like, they're pretty lenient. Like,
they're ridiculously
allowed to discuss terrorism. You are allowed to discuss vaguely terrorist acts and how they could be carried out and such. And like, that's one of the great things about how like freedom of speech in the U.S. works. It's like, we can talk about how to break into a bank's computer systems openly on an internet forum and never have the police show up at our door.
You might. And it depends, kind of, you know.
There have been isolated incidents
where, like, people, like, Adam Savage tells about, like, he was Googling for thermal detonator because he wanted to get a picture to do the prop from Star Wars, and he definitely had, like, guys in black suits show up in his store. Like, so you were looking for plans for a thermal detonator? Can we talk about that?
Yeah, but...
Well, there have been...
Even in those cases, that's not... Like, they didn't just show up because he Googled a thermal detonator.
Yeah, no, it's gonna... They'll watch you maybe more closely, but they're not gonna just show up because you did one offshoot.
Adam Savage is very, very high on the watch list. He's a little...
I would think so.
And he's like, Unabomber-level capable and nutty. And so that's what was going on there. Like, they'll show up when they have a reason to, but for the most part, you're allowed to discuss whatever you want. Certain websites will ban you from discussing certain things. Like, is on Facebook, I can't have a pro-rape Facebook group, but on Reddit, I certainly can. And while rape is definitely against the laws of every state...
I'm not sure that Reddit would necessarily... let you, because they've definitely been banning some subreddits. But I get what you're saying.
In the past, you know, there it's been a lot more lenient, I will say.
Yes, they are very lenient.
Been off of Reddit.
Let me say what I've done. I mean, I'm part of the Ubuntu ecosystem over in Europe here. I work for, I used to work for Canonical in terms of evangelism for them, although I hate that word. And I was on Reddit, and I hadn't been used to Reddit, and I didn't really enjoy the subreddit that they put up because they kept on getting all of my links taken off by a certain Nathan Haynes. So I set up another subreddit called Ubuntu Problems, and it was very easy for me to link into various Twitter messages, you know, like, this is a problem, I can't be asked filing a bug because I'm on the road. can you just do it for me? Here's the problem. I'm expressing it in a Reddit page. And that worked out really well. And everyone was like, huh, that's one way to do it. Well done. And I think that it kind of takes away from, you know, the big entities of the big subreddits. And it just means that you can federate it to a smaller subreddit and still get the job done. And that's what I like about Reddit. I'm not sure if you can do that on any of the other ones, but that's how I got noticed anyway.
Amen.
Well, I mean, there are certainly very different structures to all of these different sites, where Reddit still follows something that is at least semi-recognizable as a classic forum structure. So the ability to moderate or administer an area of Reddit can be delegated to other people, whereas unless you specifically create a Facebook page or a Twitter account as a organization where you have multiple people assigned through their back end as maintainers of that, it's much more difficult to easily have multiple people manage a specific Twitter account. Although that is actually now possible, since they have that whole they have a whole thing specifically for like brand accounts.
Yeah,
we're still waiting for Ubuntu TV, but we'll get there eventually.
Well, I think a really key point, and something a lot of people miss in this sort of discussion, is the difference between a law and a terms of service, right?
Yeah.
And this is entirely what we've been talking about for like the past 10 minutes, but it's really important to keep that in mind, where a terms of service is all right, we'll look at gun law in the U.S. I know it's a pretty hot topic, so I apologize, but
okay.
You are afforded, assuming
you've got my NRA card here somewhere.
There you go. You are afforded the right, you know, depending on your state and locality and all that, assuming you're properly licensed, a concealed carry. Not every state does it. You know, I'm in Pennsylvania. We do. So you can carry that in everywhere, I think, in PA except bars and schools, I think is what it is. I'm a rifleman, so I don't know all that. But the point I'm making here is you. Private institutions still have the right to say, no, we don't want you to bring your gun here. And they have the perfect right to do that, because that's private property at that point.
Right.
Very much so.
So that's the terms of service.
You can have one with hats in here, which is fine. And that's where the argument over the problem comes into play when you're talking about commerce and the ability to do business and refuse business under certain circumstances, which is why we have laws for protected groups where you can't do that.
Discrimination in public accommodation.
Right, yeah. And so like you bump up against what's the difference between saying I don't want to serve pizza to gays versus I don't want to serve pizza to men who wear hats? Like, that's a thing.
Because that safety dance just gets all over the place.
Yeah, I mean, how would you deal with that, really?
All right. You can dance if you want. And that's fine.
But can you leave your friends behind in the pizza place?
If they're not wearing hats, they're going to be allowed in. But if they're wearing hats, you're going to have to leave them behind. That's just the way it is. I think better than Reddit.
Now I'm thinking about it. If your friends don't dance, well, they're no friends of mine.
That's pretty exclusionary.
Well, that's okay. I'm not his friend.
I don't think any of us are wearing hats.
It's okay for businesses to say, I don't want anyone who carries a gun, even if I don't see it. I don't want to serve them at my business. However, I can't say I don't want to serve homosexuals. And those are the fights that are going on. There's people saying, why, you shouldn't be allowed to ban me simply because I'm carrying a gun. just like you people are people saying you shouldn't be allowed to ban me based on what I put my penis inside of.
Mm-hmm.
Or the configuration of my genitals, if we're going to talk about like the whole transgender thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so to a certain extent I agree, but for something like guns or like not serving people with hats, it's a choice to carry a gun. It's a choice to wear a hat. Mm-hmm. You don't get to choose, you know, whether or
sexual
not.
Sexual orientation.
Yeah, you don't get to choose that. If you're trans, that's not a choice. You don't get to choose what color your skin is. You don't get to choose what ethnicity you are, or like, there's a lot of stuff about choice. Now, if your more apt comparison would probably be, you don't want to serve people who are tall.
So, you're too tall.
Get the fuck out. Like, that's
well, now, there's an easy way. You just make the door frame really small.
Yeah, you just get one of those really old Italian houses with the tiny doors and low ceilings. No one over 6 foot will want to get inside there.
There you go. We're not saying you're not allowed in here. You just probably won't like it in here.
Yeah.
You can put up with it, sure. Well,
that's fine. A, that's what I was leading into with the protected classes and how they're chosen. But B, and so the whole reason like homosexuals aren't yet or trans LGBTQ, all of that is not a protected class is because the
that's currently at a state or local level.
Right, is because
certain state and local anti-discrimination measures have been extended to include them as protective classes.
I think he's talking about federal protected.
It's a difficult metric to easily measure.
Going back to Brent's comment just now, my understanding is that there is an executive order barring executive agencies and government contractors from discriminating, but it is not an actual statute passed by, it's not a statute of law passed by Congress, so it's up to whoever assumes the Oval Office next to continue or discard that executive order.
Right.
Interesting. Yeah, but I mean, that's the only way you could really do that and make sure it's permanent would be to make an amendment. Because those are ridiculously hard to...
Right.
Well, because if you passed a law to do it, there's nothing to stop them from just not renewing it with the next administration or trying to repeal it.
Are the current protected classes in an amendment?
They are not. They are... Is it a legal statute? Well, it's a combination of a legal statute or several legal statutes together with several Supreme Court decisions.
Okay.
Which interpret parts of the Constitution as actually barring discrimination based on those particular classes.
If you're going to make an LGBT amendment, then you're discriminating against all of the other...
Well, man, I think you would want to... I think if you were going to do it, you would make sure that everybody that you wanted in there would be covered. I don't think you'd just make one specifically for...
Right, but sadly, the easier way...
We're hitting problems with those laws now where it's like you can't discriminate on someone based on gender. Like, that's an established thing. That is.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Now we're running into that problem of people going, well, I'm a woman. Of me, someone like me going, but I'm a woman. And so you can't, and they're going, no, I don't want some guy calling himself a woman, so I'm going to discriminate against you. It's like you've got the question of what even is gender, and that's what we're bumping up against now.
Yeah.
The fact of me just walking in with my beard and saying, oh, no, I'm a woman, I'm going to use the women's restroom now. Like, people are losing their shit over this.
Although, I have to be honest, Johnny, if you walked in and said that, I'd be a little concerned.
I think I would have my doubts. Yeah.
And hey, you are very welcome and within your rights to be concerned.
I'm just saying, knowing you, Johnny.
We have to assume that you don't know.
Like, it is totally legal for me to sit around and think about having sex with children all day.
It's the action.
There are healthier things to do, Johnny.
there are much better uses of your time.
Oh, America.
I'm just saying, Johnny, if some guys in bad suits and sunglasses show up at your door real soon.
I will brought this
on yourself.
Respectfully inform them of the legal stance on the matter because they have been misinformed.
I'd still retain competent counsel.
I don't think it's going to be men showing up in my door, though. I think it's going to be probably men still, but it's they'll probably have much less clothing on, probably wife beaters. And
yes.
That is also a possibility.
Yeah, there's vigilante justice.
Yeah, they'll be much less interested in how the legal system works.
Yes.
they're not too interested in, you know, the right to a day in court.
Yeah, I'll just keep an eye. I'll just set up a Google alert for Chicago area man in cat ears.
Yeah, and the phrase "for no reason" will definitely be in there.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm sure they'll.
He is beaten in his home for no reason.
Oh man.
It's exactly how the statement's taken in italics for no reason.
Do nothing is what it's gonna say.
Earlier, I'm surprised we were using Reddit as the paragon of liberal speech here.
I think,
liberal, oh, not God, politically,
no.
But God,
no, yeah.
I think 4chan would probably be the the target we're looking for there.
So, on an exciting 4chan.
If you want an example of,
I believe it was CNN recently. So they did a piece about the alt-right. And then linked directly to poll. Like in the article, it's like Reddit. And it's like Reddit.com/alt-right. They're like, okay, that's probably all right. And it's like 4chan.org/poll. I'm like, oh God, no, why did you do that?
That's
so those so poor people with no expectation of what they expect.
Why would you even put the URL up?
Because CNN is idiots, apparently.
Yes. Yeah.
That was definitely someone at CNN knowing exactly what they were doing.
I can only hope this is someone's
last day at CNN, and they were going out with a bang. By
Let me see if I can find... I think I don't have the actual article. I think I got linked the archive.is of it. But let me see if I can find that. I'm going to post it.
Yeah, 4chan, you can make child porn be on topic for literally anything.
That's this 4chan. Is kind of one of the reasons why in these discussions I try to avoid bringing up 4chan.
If you really want an
example of a completely free and either libertarian or anarchist type of society, depending on who you ask. Yeah, sure, 4chan. Great. Yeah. Just keep it away from me.
I think that should be the link.
I'm going to regret this, but I'm clicking that.
CNN Politics by Gregory Krieg?
Yeah, Gregory Krieg. You should check and see if he's got a more recent byline.
Well, what is the current byline? What is it?
Updated, let's see, 2113 GMT, August the 25th.
Yeah, let's see if I can get... Oh, just to, wait,
just
there
to
we
test,
go.
Just to test Johnny's theory.
All right, so edition.cnn.com, here's the actual link. That's nice.
Yeah,
I appreciate
no, they
that
did, in fact, link
that.
Directly to both... Reddit and 4chan. Oh, and Breitbart.
Oh, man.
That's like the trifecta right there, right?
Yeah.
I think they just missed out on InfoWars.
InfoWars.
Oh, God. Yep. No, it's still there. Ford.4chan.org/poll.
Check out Gregory King's short bio. It's amazing.
Like, how amazing are we talking?
I'll read it to you. Gregory Krieg is a reporter at CNN Politics covering buzzy political news.
Of course.
Is that it?
Is there any other sort of political
news? Well, that's
a short one. Is that actually a complete sentence?
Yeah. Here's a... Oh, my God. Here's his Twitter account.
Oh.
Right there. Twitter account is at Greg J. Krieg, K-R-I-E-G.
This is political news. Jesus.
He's offbeat, formerly. He used to be at Mike. Now he's NABC.
Yeah. Well, he's...
This is a shittier short bio than what I put in for a speaker at Hope. And that was really... Did you guys see what my speaker profile was at Hope?
No, but give me a moment and I'll bring it up.
I'm pretty sure it was one line. It's like, Beaches works at Radio Statler.
Yeah, he's got a Turner.com email address.
Ooh. Wow. Fancy.
Fancy-schmancy.
All right. So, like, what we weren't here to mock him. We were here to...
No, we were here to talk
no,
about...
No, Beaches, you managed an entire two sentences
I
there.
Got two sentences, yes.
Beaches has been attending Hope since Hope number 9, parentheses 2012. New sentence, he has also been involved with Radio Statler since then.
What I think is funny is that's definitely not the bio that I gave them. I think I got four sentences in there.
Mm. Yeah, no, I mean, they lopped off a good chunk of my bio. Apparently they didn't like my line about the top of my head being a recurring character on Law & Order.
His Twitter account is weird.
How weird is it?
I noticed a few more 4chan links in there, too.
This is... Yeah, hang on. We can... I'm going to Twitter dork this.
Oh, God.
Go on while I do this.
Is that a term you're trying to get people to pick up now?
Dorking, like, as a verb is a thing, and so I don't just put whatever you're dorking in front of that.
No, no. Makes sense.
It's not a Google dork, it's a Twitter dork. I'm doing it inside of Twitter, so it is a weird... Anyway.
So what exactly, when you use dorking as a verb, what are you using it to say?
Crafting, writing a particularly crafty search term to hunt down results that may not be something you would come across by a normal typing crap into a search box.
Huh.
You would, you know, when you're writing from and like from this person to that person between these dates using the phrase XYZ, you know, that stuff. Versus just like typing a phrase into the Twitter search and hoping whatever you get back is what you were looking for. That's what I consider dorking.
Okay.
So it's basically knowing what the fuck you're doing when you do a search.
Yeah, just like knowing what the Twitter search box or whatever search box is able to handle.
Mm.
You know, in Gmail, you know, you can type from and subject and shit. It's that, but in other websites.
Okay. Yeah, that's cool.
Or define colon word in Google. Yeah. Got it.
I guess in Google, because Google also has functions you can call like define.
Mm-hmm.
Dorking is more prolific and pronounceable. But yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, Google actually has the ability to interpret at least some Boolean operators.
Right, it is the Twitter search.
Which, well...
I'm defending...
Oh, Penguin Trooper's getting a cigar. I'll have to ask him about that.
What?
Just don't sit through that documentary piece that Bloomberg TV did on stupidly expensive cigars. Guy I share an office with decided to watch that all afternoon.
Oh my god.
Like, I really don't need to hear about the $47,000 box of Romeo y Julieta from before the embargo.
I run the Cigar Sec Twitter account and I can't listen to that shit.
Yeah.
I am Cigar Sec and I have no interest in that.
So someone actually had another idea?
I only found one tweet of his that actually has 4chan in it, but he may be obfuscating his URLs by, not intentionally, but through a...
Right, but just the link shorteners.
Yeah. So that's going to be problematic. He does not appear to use the string 4chan outside of a URL.
I wish that I could pay Facebook money to not show me ads anymore.
Oh, he just did one yesterday.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just looking at his raw feed. There's one right there. Like, his very last tweet. Like, there's his pinned tweet, then there's his last recent tweet.
Yeah, I'm going back. I've only found one back through April. Oh, well. He's not the hero we were hoping for.
But is he the hero we deserve?
That's the real question.
I'm gonna tweet at him.
That's really kind of terrifying if he is. I'd like to think that, you know, we're deserving of something at least a little bit classier.
What does this even mean? What is this? What is this tweet? After she sent him a cartoon image of a pump bottle of hand lotion and a box of tissues, Wiener. He responded with a graphic homemade text and emoji image of an ejaculating penis. Like, we're talking ASCII art, or like, did he just send like B?
No, like straight up emojis.
Yeah, like.
Is there an emoji for penis? Like, is that?
No, usually people use the eggplant emoji for penis. By the way,
so you like?
I learned that from the kids.
Yeah, and then you combine them to create images. Lindsay, math crab Lindsay is really good at like crafting new emoji out of existing emoji. Like, she made an awesome Clippy emoji. And it's like eyes and it's made out of
things. Now that I have to see.
And I was like, how the fuck did you do this?
That I have to see, Johnny.
I'm gonna find it. I'll have to go through a massive bank of bizarre texts that we exchange.
I feel like Greg Krieg might be younger than me, and if I need to explain to him what emoji sexting is, that's usually a bad sign.
I mean, it is possible that he was trying to explain what emoji sexting is to people that are older than him. I mean, he does work at CNN.
I doubt that.
He works at CNN.
But he also uses millennial terminology like barfs everywhere.
Mm.
Well, because, you know, buzzy politics.
Oh, right, right. Buzzy politics.
He's got to be down with those young kids.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I'm gonna message Darko here. I just saw that he was.
There you go. By the way, just I don't know how many of you know Glitch Tech.
Yeah.
At least in passing. Cool kid.
Passing as in is no longer around?
No, he's still around.
Know us in passing means you're aware of his existence, not about his passing. So if we want to talk about people passing...
I did not say anything... Oh, yes,
Gene Wilder is apparently...
Rest in peace.
No longer with us.
The word was in passing. I said in passing, not about.
The in cut out, and I just heard Glitch Detect's passing, and I went...
Oh, yeah, no. No. I mean, unless he blew himself up with an air compressor in the last 20 minutes, I'm pretty sure he's okay.
Okay.
Of course, you would hear about that on Twitter.
I mean, we wouldn't unless someone, like, finds his partially exploded phone and manages to tweet, the guy that owns this just blew himself up with an air compressor or something. I don't think any of us would ever know.
Yeah.
Which would be really unfortunate.
He should really hook up, like, a life monitor system to his Twitter account.
He really
so
should.
We know.
My Twitter account's definitely it's a false canary because I schedule so much shit to post.
Dude, you have mentioned that.
Yeah.
Yeah, reverse canary.
Right?
Patenting right.
So if men with sunglasses show up about you thinking about diddling kids all day long,
we won't
really know about it for like 3 weeks, is what you're saying.
I didn't say diddling.
You said thinking about it.
I didn't say...
No. He said thinking about having sex with.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry. There's that distinction.
Yes.
Conviction is what it is. It's like you're going to fucking do something, then fucking do it.
Commit to it is what you're saying.
Yeah.
I guess once you commit sexual abuse against a minor, you're kind of gonna get the same sentence regardless. So.
Yeah, there's that sort of a point of no return, I guess.
Yeah.
I suppose. Oh my god.
But seriously, Johnny, stop it.
Jesus. What? How did we get to this? What the fuck?
Well, because the judge likes
Johnny,
sentences
Johnny,
based on the
Johnny,
severity of crime. Yes.
You're just gonna make this worse.
You're gonna get old.
How about we talk about
now? He's gotta commit. Now he's gotta commit to it.
Well, let's talk about Pegasus. Can we talk about Pegasus?
I'm gonna make it worse. That's my goal. I'm hoping.
Pegasus, literally anything else?
What people have
been doing since Hope? We have lots of options aside from.
There's a. I guess I can plug the new official 2600 Facebook group.
Not yet.
Let's not do that yet until we're sure that it's actually official this time.
It is. We've gotten.
It's not public.
Let's let it actually get like a month or two old.
It'll be there when it's there.
Okay.
Yeah.
TSA advertising job openings on top of pizza boxes?
Wait, what? All right.
This was why I mentioned Glitch Tech. He was, as you may know, he is a avid model aircraft / quadcopter flyer and builder, and he was going on a bit of a rant earlier about the new FAA regulations, where basically the way the rules currently work is that there is no way to actually get the hobbyist license from the FAA. Basically, you have to go through an exam administered by the TSA, which somehow is now concerned with people's ability to safely operate aircraft. Not that they actually have anything to do with that whatsoever.
No, I think it's they're concerned with people being allowed to operate aircraft, not their ability to do so.
Except they still aren't responsible for that either.
They are now.
Well, yes. Yes, but...
I'm using the logic of they make sure... Their job is to make sure people who blow up planes don't get on planes, or people who fly planes into other things don't get on planes, and this is an extension of that. Like, somebody who's being allowed to fly a plane should, you know, be given a quickie once-over to make sure...
Yeah, except that the FAA doesn't... Or the TSA has nothing to do with with the licensing scheme for actual pilots who fly, you know, multi-thousand-pound long-haul aircraft filled with thousands of gallons of jet fuel.
But that's and I don't operate in that realm, and I can't speak to this. But if past events are any indicator. Terrorists are not interested in those. They're interested in taking an insignificant number of people down with them because they feel that makes things more... Like crashing a UPS jet into the World Trade Center wasn't something they wanted to do, even though that would have been much easier. They wanted to crash a jet full of amount of people, feeling that makes a bigger difference.
Sure, but I'm saying that as far as I know, the TSA is still not responsible for administering the licensing exams for commercial aircraft pilots.
But somehow they
are being given the responsibility for administering the competency test for light commercial unmanned vehicles.
Competency test?
Yeah.
As in determining if you are
qualified to actually operate the thing.
Like model airplanes?
Yes. Yes. Or quote unquote drones.
So what No, wait. Let's back up here. Let me get this straight. So they're concerned.
Your statement is so preposterous that it's confused all of us, even though we don't understand all of the words.
So, like, a 2-foot by 2-foot quadcopter, they're worried about being used in some sort of quote-unquote, I guess, unsafe manner intentionally, or malignant manner, I guess we could say. They're worried about that, and they're trying to prevent that. What sort of payload can a quadcopter carry?
So, I'm trying to find the story that he was referencing.
That's a question, sir. Watch how you phrase that, because someone's going to show you.
Right, yeah.
So...
You can hold more than 3 ounces of liquid on a quadcopter. You know how much shampoo a quadcopter can haul?
Oh my god. We're all doomed. So,
unfortunately, the FAA statement is, as with most other government announcements, mostly composed of things that read similar to, the new regulations don't apply to model aircraft operations that meet all the criteria specified in Section 336 of Public Law 112-95, which is now codified in Part 101, including the stipulation they be operated only for hobby or recreational purposes, which makes it rather difficult to actually make sense of what it is that they're saying here. But the main thing seems to be that in order to comply with Part 107 regulations, which is any remote-controlled or unmanned aircraft that exceeds their very amorphous and ill-defined definition of model aircraft,
elsewhere,
or is being done for commercial purposes, you have to be licensed under Part 107, which includes a TSA-administered exam.
I think the TSA-administered exam is not competency. It is making sure it's like the same as the, making sure you're not going to fly 3 ounces of shampoo into a...
into the jetway?
Into a fertilizer manufacturing plant.
Right.
And it has such active questions as, do you intend to fly shampoo into fertilizer?
Okay, here we go. Here we go.
Yeah, some of the questions. I mean,
the Illinois flight card exam includes questions such as, you know, have you been like convicted or have you been found to have any of the following mental disabilities or whatever? And it's like you can just check no, and then you're done. Like who's
Okay, so here we go. Here's a clarification that hopefully actually is correct, since it is the FAA's own publication summarizing Part 107 regulations, but not Part 101, which does clarify that it is a TSA security vetting for Part 61 pilot certificate holders. This is in order to qualify for a remote pilot certificate. It's still unclear exactly what the limitations on the craft are, but there are some things about light conditions and airspeed and altitude and so on. But it's still an agency that decided that the best way to secure good, competent security screeners was to advertise on the top of Domino's pizza boxes. Not exactly...
surefire way to get some quality applicants.
Yes. It's not exactly confidence-inspiring.
Hey, on that note, are those Domino's delivery vehicles self-driving?
Oh, those new ones? I don't think they are yet. They just have a built-in oven, so they're like 80% of the way there to get to being a deliverator.
I like how your metric for determining how close you are to being a self-driving car is.
Do you have an oven?
No, deliverator. Oven,
so they're deliverator. Like 80%.
Deliverator from Snow Crash.
Oh, deliverator. All right, that's
not valid. Terminator.
Oh,
deliverator.
God.
Yeah, nope, totally.
No, oh, man.
No, the Deliverator was not self-driving, though.
It was not, but it was also capable of running other cars off the road and evading
the high-speed pursuit. You can't forget looking menacing.
Deliverator.
So that people get the fuck out of your way.
They need, like, a Deliverator Mark II, where it's, like, Deliverator plus Knight Rider.
Yes, like, there
yeah,
we go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Then it has the self-driving capabilities.
Michael, yeah, the pizza has dropped 5 degrees.
Guys, wait. The Deliverator was the driver, I thought.
Was it?
Yes.
I don't think
it's not a reference to the vehicle. It's to the person.
There was never a name given to...
Yeah.
Just the Deliverator's car. It was just the Deliverator's car. That's the only name it was ever given.
It's like Frankenstein versus Frankenstein's monster.
Yes, it's a bit of a Frankenstein's monster sort of thing.
Really, can we consider the Deliverator the entire unit of the driver plus the car?
In theory. I mean, according to the theory...
What is a driver?
Because once the pizza was handed off to YT, YT became the Deliverator. And YT did not...
I thought it used like some terminology like conscripted or something like that.
Should I go get the book? I have the book.
We'll sit here and wait.
There's a shelf right over here.
Yeah,
hold on.
Wait while you read the entire book.
I haven't read it in about 3 years, so
I haven't read it in a decade.
Yeah.
I haven't read it in like
legitimately
9 months.
A decade.
Yep.
I read that in like 8th grade, and then I read it after The Matrix came out, because I was like, holy shit, this is a movie about, not Necromancer.
There we go. One of my more current copies.
What the... Snow Crash. That's...
Yeah, Snow Crash is completely unrelated
to... Been. I can reference specific things from the book, but still not remember them.
Yeah. I actually have this really big issue where I read... Snow Crash, and then I read, like, all of Gibson's novels.
Oh, no, yeah.
And now I've completely confused the two of them, so I don't remember which one had the giant mechs, but I remember it being awesome.
The one with the giant mechs.
I have not read the newest one.
I thought, wasn't there, maybe that was a different book.
There was one
where they were building, like, giant robots out of trash. Or not trash, but, like, at the junkyard they were putting together, like, hydraulic robots. Am I misremembering that?
Gibson didn't write Snow Crash.
No, it was Stevenson. The issue is that I read Snow Crash and then went like directly into...
The problem was he was playing a lot of Mech Warrior at the time, and it all just kind of...
It all blended together, and then I can't even...
Do any of you guys play Hawken?
No.
The new mech game?
I haven't played like any mech games.
Okay.
Okay, so let's see... I've gotten up to the exchange of the business cards. Answer the card.
So anyway.
At no point is YT named as the Deliverator.
Okay.
Just the note that as YT... takes off with the pizza, Hero, who as of 30 seconds ago is no longer the Deliverator, gets out of the car and pulls his swords out of the trunk.
So I think that implies that YT has become the Deliverator.
Or is it just...
I think it's also implied at that point that due to his wrecking of the car and almost certainly screwing up the delivery, he's probably been fired.
Yeah.
Probably instantaneous, but that does not necessarily imply that a new Deliverator is named, because YT is also not employed by...
Correct.
Tony.
Going through the chapter in which YT in fact delivers the pizza, and I am not seeing an instance of the phrase deliverator there.
Did anybody get an ebook? You could just search for that term.
I have it in there too, but it's too much difficulty to look it up right now. But if, in case someone has pulled it up, it would be chapter 4 in which such a reference would likely occur. Because I am a font of useless information.
Would you call yourself the Comic Sans of fonts of useless information?
Not really.
Because you're not a useless font of useless information? You're very effective.
No, I just like to think I have some sort of class.
It's a class of font.
Did you guys ever read Islands in the Net by Bruce Sterling?
No.
Oh, was that an essay?
No. It's a novel. It's really? Like proto-cyberpunk.
Brent, are you the guy from the Sysadmin podcast?
Yes, that's me. Yeah, I'm the guy with the dreads.
And then where did Kira come from?
I have no idea.
That's a mystery.
I think he's been wanting to join for, I think, the scale of months.
Yeah.
And it's just never kind of worked
out. That happens. Islands in the Net. The title sounds very familiar, but if it's long enough to be a novel unto itself, I don't have it on my shelf, which is a bit odd because I thought I had most of his stuff.
Who? It's a Sterling novel, Bruce Sterling.
Yes. No, I have. Okay. I have an extensive collection of Bruce Sterling, William Gibson, and Neal Stephenson.
Oh, nice. Yeah, it's a 1988.
So after my Mirror Shades collection was published, but earlier than most of my other Bruce Sterling books.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's not, it's certainly not what you would expect from like a Gibson or something, but oh gosh, just using his last name makes me think Hack the Gibson. No, it's not what you'd expect from like a Gibson, but
yeah, I mean, it's...
Gibson was named after him.
Yeah, exactly. But just the phrase made me think of hackers, and now I'm just totally off track.
Well, next time we do one of these podcasts, I'm just gonna pop the DVD in here and do a screen share the entire time.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, if you want one way to probably get us banned off of YouTube, it's probably that.
Oh no, I'll turn the sound off.
They'll do it. I have faith. If there's one thing that will fuck us, it will be something to deal with copyright. We actually, Johnny, just. Typing line break in all caps does not make a line break.
Johnny.
Wait, let's try this.
Johnny, it's line break. It's...
You gotta... It's win. You have to be respectful of the Windows people and make sure you do...
CLRF?
Sure, yeah, you have to do the carriage return as well as the line feed, or else, you can go fuck yourself.
There we go.
What is it? So that's also like N and then L? What's the fucking other one? N and O.
It's caret M.
Caret C?
Caret M.
Yeah.
I know this because there's been many times where people will send me, it's like, okay, here's the list of shit that you need to like import into this database or blah, blah, blah. And then I'm like, okay, let me just cat/ET motherfucking caret M's every fucking line.
Oh, dude. DOS to Unix.
Yeah, I know. It's very easy. I just fucking hate that I have to do it all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm saying there's a binary that does that for you.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. It's just, in a perfect world, I wouldn't have to deal with it, period. If you know that stuff's going to be on Unix, like that's the thing, too, is that if you use a decent text editor for Windows, like Notepad++, you can just tell it to use Unix line endings, and then all of your shit's written in Unix line endings, period.
I thought you stop breaking line feeds from a properly designed Unix text file.
Wait, oh,
there you go. I thought you could do that in vanilla Notepad, though. You could save it as...
Notepad always does character return line feed. Well, so the issue with Notepad, and the reason why it's not more featureful, is that the text input box is... That's, like, the base class for every random text box in Windows. So if it was more featureful, it would actually make things worse.
Yeah, the text box, it's the text box button, or what do you call
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it's the input for, yeah, it's the object for a text box is literally just Notepad, which is definitely, if you've ever done, like, the tutorials for, like, how to do Python, for like, the Python bindings for WX widgets, I don't know if anybody's ever done that, but if you're trying to learn WX widgets, they'll make you write a Notepad editor, like, and that's what you end up with, is it's just the base box. Which WX widgets is phenomenal if you need to write stuff that's cross-platform.
Does anybody like my kid and play haircut?
It has gotten more and more impressive.
I think you need about another 3 inches.
I like
you get there. Yeah, what do you know about hair? I'm going to part it on the left.
What happened to spiky hair?
You need to gel it up in the front and then get it frosted.
Frosted.
That's how you know that. That's how you tell people that you're attractive, right? Is just get the frosted tip.
Let me ask the missus.
Oh gosh.
I'm
Dallin's girlfriend.
Should do is just gel the front and then just let the back like mat.
Oh, you mean like because that's here.
Is that
is it long enough? Can you do like an inverted, like party in the front, business in the back? Wait, I think that's what that is.
Yeah.
No, that's wait, that's no the profile? Old man.
The reverse mullet.
That is definitely a reverse mullet, because if you look in the back, it looks like it's nice and like a military cut, like fade, and then in the front you just have
Yahoo Serious.
Party coming, business going.
Yahoo Serious.
Oh my gosh. I missed that, but oh my gosh, I remember. Is he still alive? What happened to him?
I don't know.
What was the Australian movie?
Crocodile
Dundee. I think him and Crocodile Dundee are gay married and living out their life in the bayou or the outback, one or the other.
Oh my gosh.
Remember Billy?
Someone's going to write that now.
You heard it here.
His website is still up, and it's the official Yahoo Serious site.
Yeah,
well, it's good to know that.
Can we get a link in here official. So that I can have it in the
in the August description? 2000, Yahoo Serious tried to search engine.
Oh God! What the ever loving
product infringement?
That hair! Holy shit!
What did he trademark his hair?
He put out a movie in 2000 that I don't even remember.
Yahoo's Australia. that reminds me. I think that's the name for the podcast. Is party coming, business leaving? Was that how you put it?
Party coming, business going.
Party coming.
That's what he looks like now. By the way,
party coming, business going.
I think that's the name of the podcast. Front,
business in the rear.
Party coming, business going. I like it.
I love it.
redirecting. Oh God!
Right, that's him now.
He looks almost normal.
What do you look at?
The link I just posted.
Oh, okay.
That's Yahoo Serious now.
Oh, well, yeah, I'm sure he looked sort of normal with his hair down. Everyone.
Oh, God.
If you spiked your hair, you'd look fucking crazy, too.
I don't think I could get my hair to spike. But, oh, my gosh, could you imagine if I could?
This is... This site is just terrible that. And...
Yeah. Boop, doop, boop, boop.
This is... Wow.
Tens of thousands InfoWars accounts have been leaked.
Oh, that's
no.
I was on JB Live earlier.
Huh. Never mind.
What's this?
What was the source of the leak? Do we know?
Why does it do that? Why does it do the redirect?
I will say I do have to appreciate Yahoo Sirius's warning on his website.
It's very solid, as opposed to liquid or gaseous.
Yes.
Do you want to read it or should I? YahooSirius.com is for external use only. If while using this site your computer is accidentally swallowed, you should immediately unplug it from its electrical socket before seeking professional medical advice.
Yes.
Sirius Entertainment, Pty Ltd. 2003. Site designer Peter Zagrzewski.
Post that in the thread. The thing. I'm gonna go do some incense down right now.
Do you guys know what his birth name is? It's Greg Gomez Peed.
What?
Greg Gomez Peed. P-E-A-D.
Where's the site designers? There it is. I got it.
And it has a mail to. It has a legitimate mail to link.
To be fair, I'm guilty of them, but.
I actually was trying to apply for a job and I found out that their mail to link was incorrect. Like it had the wrong email address and was broken. So I figured out what their thing was and then I emailed them and was like, your link's broke. Also, I'm applying for a job, but your link's broken. You should fix that. You know what? 3 years later, pretty sure it's still fucking broken. Let me see if I can find it.
I can't find anyone on LinkedIn that looks like they may be him.
Well, the mail to goes to Google Mail, so at least the spam's not being managed by them.
Is it? It's because the mail to says it's mail at. They have a. It says ruski.com.au is the mail to link, right?
I just run a who is on that.
Yeah. I mean, it's probably the dude. Oh, yeah, talking about who is. I fucked up the other day. And I registered a .us domain name. And the way that I registered it is I emailed the guys who register and run all of my shit. It was like, hey, I want to register. This is the domain. Just please do it with a year's worth of hosting and blah, blah, blah. And just take care of it and then shoot me the invoice and we'll be good. And then they did. And then because it's a .us, they used like all of my actual information without any privacy screening or anything.
Right.
It's normal. But apparently, I didn't realize this was a thing. People just troll who is for newly registered web URLs, and then will spam the ever-loving fuck out of it.
Yeah. Yep.
The best part is it has my actual direct front line phone number, so I've been getting phone calls with people from literally India that are like, hey, we want to do your web address, and I'm like, no.
I accidentally did that at like 5 a.m. one night for work, out of like tired frustration, I just like quickly spun up a domain and like I was like, I'll deal with this later. Like 8 a.m. I was getting fucking phone calls from my boss, like livid because like he was just getting like abused with spam. Like 3 hours later. Yeah.
What the worst part is about it too is that it's like it's not like you're getting hit by a lot of people, but it's not harassment because they're all different people. So you feel like you're being harassed, but you're not. It's not the same person, so you can't like legally tell them to fuck off.
Well, the you good, can always the legally good news, tell them to fuck off.
Well, but. You can tell them to fuck off, but
he's not going to do anything.
You have to do it one person at a time.
Yeah, first half of this podcast.
Like, the worst thing about Twitter, too, is like that, where if you say something that people find objectionable or something, you'll oftentimes find that people will just, like, one person will, like, everybody tweets at you once to tell you you're an asshole. I've never personally done this because I don't actually really use my Twitter, but like you'll see that sometimes where people, one person says something that's kind of questionable or some people disagree with, and then everybody tells them once, and it feels like they're being harassed, but it's really just a lot of people think you're a dick.
Yeah.
Beaches, the good news is while the emails never stop, the phone calls stop after about a year, so... You can have that to look forward to.
I really wish...
Here's the thing, too. I bet you if I change the who is information, it's not going to stop...
Probably not, no.
Because it's already out there.
Still... I've had, my phone number for, I don't know, 5 years, something like that, maybe a bit longer. I am still getting calls that are very obviously intended for someone... who used to have this number.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That happens with me. So I have a New Orleans number, even though I live in Philly. Because I lived in New Orleans for a couple years. Not any fun reason. But I've had this number for maybe about 7 years, and I'll still get numbers, I'll still get calls from a school saying, hey, your son didn't show up to school today. And I'm like, I have a son?
Well, I'm a dad!
who didn't tell me that I had a kid?
Exactly.
Well, now I'm doubly concerned. I haven't know about, and he didn't show up to school.
And he's a truant. It just gets worse and worse.
A truant.
This is the worst day ever.
But no, I'm still getting those really obviously fake credit card processing company calls.
Oh yeah.
Because for some reason. Someone has that number listed somewhere as a business.
Oh, no.
I also get random calls asking for random Hispanic people, but that's a...
I've been getting...
That's just the exchange that I'm served from.
I call that Michael Jordaning. It's like, if you just call enough houses and ask for, like, a Gonzalez, you're going to get a decent amount of hits.
Eventually you will, in fact, get a Gonzalez, yes.
That's just their default script. How can I speak to Mr. Gonzalez?
Okay, wait, so me and the other... the co-hosts on my show, we saw the thing on Facebook of all places.
None of this plug in other shows.
No. I'm not even gonna mention the show. But this is how I know.
Massive audience.
Calm down,
Johnny. Wait, Johnny, did you just say our massive audience?
We've had literally one viewer tonight. One. I know him on Facebook. That's the only reason why he was watching.
Hey. Don't knock the one viewer. That's far more than we normally get.
this is like a 1 billion percent
increase from our usual audience.
I think our largest number of live viewers was 3. I think one of those instances was I forgot to close it in another tab. Yes. I was like, why is everything echoing? What is going on? Oh, I'm just
that one. That was a good
Brent,
time.
What's the secret to getting viewers?
There
Don't
you
be
go.
Us.
So,
giveaways.
Anyway, you had a point.
Well, it's not a point. It's more so just an anecdote. So we saw this thing on Facebook of all things, where one guy texted the number one below him saying, "Hey, text our neighbor," and we were like, "Oh my gosh, we need to do that." I did it. I tried both one up and one down. Both were invalid numbers, unfortunately. Payton did it, and he got what we think was a teenage girl, so we didn't really try and continue conversation, but they were pretty amused. Jathan tried it, but I don't think he ever got a response. But that's such a great way to meet strangers.
My dad. Wait,
so what are we doing? We're texting persons that are incrementally close to our personal phone numbers?
Yes. Yeah, they're your text door neighbors. So you gotta... So you
increment
one up or one down, or both.
By one.
Yeah.
That doesn't work for me because I have had my mobile phone number long enough that... I actually own a block.
Oh my gosh. I love
so,
it.
So, Johnny...
And I'm in the middle of that block.
What are you doing?
So you'd be in the same position I am.
Oh, I thought I had the mic covered up. I'm sorry.
No, you were looking on LinkedIn for Peter Zakruski.
Oh, yeah.
And then if you go to his fucking... The URL listed in the mail to, he has a contact... page literally that links to his LinkedIn.
Yeah, that's funny.
I mean, I just looked him up on the Australian Whois directory.
I was just incrementally
and that turned up a Gmail address, which is just that same name at gmail.com. And I'm not sure if it's something unique about Aust Registry or the requirements of the .com.au domain or TLD, but literally the only information seems to be his name and that Gmail address. But let's see, what does LinkedIn say he's been up to since he built that website back in 2003?
I personally, if I had designed that website, I would probably ask them to remove my name.
Let's see. He is a digital account manager at Super Retail Group in Sydney, Australia.
I didn't think that was him. Okay.
He has 500-plus connections, and 10 people have recommended him.
And he's apparently walked 775 kilometers, according to his blog. Oh, 75 kilometers through Spain in 28
days. I did this to the guy who made, to like all the people who made the Space Jam website. I went through, like, followed through and connected with them on Facebook and sent them messages. Or on Facebook, on LinkedIn.
Okay, here it is. His job title... When he was with the AFTRS, which seems to be the company name that he used when designing that website for Yahoo Serious, 5 months at AFTRS, graphic/slash web designer, worked with stakeholders across various departments to identify information for communication to wider organization and wider community, produced monthly online and offline newsletters, maintained internet and internet site content, and redeveloped suite of print and electronic stationery in line with brand style guide. Thrilling. Through sustained marketing efforts, saw the graduation show screen in more cinemas and more sold-out evenings than previous years. That's kind of weird. Okay. Also lists himself as a freelance graphic and web designer from March of 1998 through April of 2006, which covers that entire period. And also, somehow, his entire time earning his Bachelor of Design.
Oh my gosh. So he walked 700... What were you saying?
He has a Twitter. I kind of want to follow him from the Radio Statler account.
Do it and be like, hey, you're famous.
Hey, we're telling you, our tiny podcast is discussing you.
Or we could be like, hey, Peter, we saw that you walked 775 kilometers. Do you know what that almost is? That's almost 500 miles.
And would you walk 500 more just to be the man?
Well, yeah, I don't know.
You walked 1,000 miles to fall down at your door.
There you go.
A guitar,
yeah.
We could jam it out.
We can have like a requiem for Peter, even though he's not even dead.
I walked 775 kilometers, and I would walk 775 kilometers more. Just to be the man. and walk to
Wait. I need to check this. Were Proclaimers not a U.S. group? Were they?
No,
were they from the U.K.?
I don't fucking know.
I thought so.
They were Scottish.
Yeah, I thought that they were.
Why are they? Why are they measuring in miles?
Well, so actually, yeah. So even I think even in Britain and most of the UK, I think they still use miles, don't they?
Sort of.
They do both, right?
Britain is pretty well converted, especially in the metropolitan areas.
Proclaimers.co.uk.
Yep. Around, and actually, they are touring in the U.S. They're touring in the U.S. Yeah.
Guys, let's all get together and see a Proclaimer show.
Oh, holy shit. Okay, September 16th, they're going to be in Philly, and September 15th, they're going to be in Alexandria.
Oh my God,
let's do it.
Hang on, I'm going to be in D.C.
there you go. That's just a metro right away.
I can't make it on the 15th, though. I have previous engagements.
I will be in D.C. on that date.
You will or you won't?
Never mind. I'm way back in Chicago by then. Never mind.
And then there's New York on September 17th. What else we got? Come on.
Let's wait till
Northampton, Massachusetts, Ridgeville, Buffalo. What the fuck? They're going New York to Massachusetts to Connecticut, back to New York, and then up to Ontario.
Ah, here's
Buffalo, Toronto, and then Cleveland. Hey, Chicago, Friday, September 30th. Get your tickets.
Part yeah, west. There you go.
I'm here. I'm not going to go see it by myself, you weirdos.
Okay, so here's the
I
thing.
I can see about coming to Chicago.
I have a ton of places for you guys to sleep if you come here. Tons of room.
Yes.
If we ever did the Radio StatlerCon.
So here's the thing.
We were talking about that.
So before we move on to this, just to settle this whole thing about why a bunch of Scottish guys were singing about measurements in miles.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. The requirement for metric conversion only came into place in 1995, and that was only for packaged goods.
Oh.
2000 for goods sold loose by weight. And in fact, at this time, there is an open-ended sunset period for the use of certain very specific volume and distance measurements, specifically things like pint, troy ounce, mile, yard, foot, and inch, and and the acre.
Well, I
for
mean,
some
they
reason,
were
those yeah. are those are still allowed for specific uses.
Yeah, they still use acres for property sales.
Yes, yes, property registration is what they still allow acres for. Let's see, linear distance measures for road traffic signs, distance and speed measurement. The imperial pint for the dispensing of draft beer and cider, and the sale of milk in returnable containers, and the troy ounce for transactions in precious metals.
Well, I think the final answer.
We're talking about it.
They're based out of the U.S. So.
Well, they may be now.
Right.
Well, that's good because otherwise they would need to change the song when they sing it.
They
because,
would.
I mean, technically. 500 miles walking to her door is the transport of packaged goods. Hey-o!
Hello!
So,
yeah, but I don't think 804.672 kilometers has the same ring to it, you know?
No.
It doesn't. Really kind of screws with the beat.
The measurements of the length of my package.
Half an inch.
more like millimeters, am I right?
It is much more impressive that way.
There you go.
Then again, I think 500 millimeters is actually still pretty.
500 millimeters?
50 centimeters.
500 millimeters would be 5 centimeters.
Yes.
Right.
about 2 feet.
Mm. 5 centimeters is not 2 feet.
Well, no, it's
you that guy and
right, hold him. On. 500 centimeters. And
Peaches, just click the link.
Stop using Wolfram Alpha's computing power for this.
I'm using Google. What you talking about?
Yeah, we're using Google's computing power for this, dude.
500 centimeters is 16. No, millimeters, motherfucker. Hold on. Millimeters. 1.64 feet.
Yeah, so I was right.
So, yeah, it's a foot and two-thirds.
Okay. The significant other is giving me a response on the hair frosting idea. I said, hey, should I get my hair frosted? And then I just thought, trick question on its own. And then her response was the equally tricky question of, do you want to get your hair frosted?
That's probably a good sign.
That question.
And
then I said, well, the podcast agrees that it would make me more comely, to which she responded...
comely.
And she responded, then don't get your hair frosted.
Well, I think you've gotten the answer.
The appropriate response.
Radio Challenge said to do it, said don't do it.
You heard it here, folks.
Johnny's not allowed to get his hair frosted unless he enjoys sleeping on the couch.
I hate to say this, but so we started about 8:40 Eastern, and it's now like 10:20, so this is, we probably should at some point consider wrapping this up. Yeah.
Wait, give me those times again.
8:40, and it's now 10:20.
Oh, yeah, okay, that's longer than I thought you were saying.
Huh. Yeah.
That's weird. I've only gone through 2 beers.
Well, you must have been savoring them. Or they were quite large.
No.
I had a Pepsi Max.
Regular size?
I don't know. Can't find a damn volume label. Damn you, metric system. whatever the standard 6-pack size bottle of Stella comes in.
It's probably either 12 ounces or 500.
It's definitely not 500.
Not 500 ounces, 500, it's half a liter.
Milliliters.
Yeah.
That's, no.
So it's probably like a 12 ounce.
11.2 fluid ounces.
11.2, so. Why yeah. 12?
Nominally 12.
Oh, yeah.
It takes up the same amount of space as a 12 ounce bottle, but.
I just discovered pony beers today.
What?
Pony beers? I did not know those were a thing. The little.
Oh, yeah.
Sidecar beers? Yeah.
Yeah, the little. Isn't that the size that Red Stripe comes in?
No, smaller.
Yeah.
Oh!
Like 8 ounces.
Oh, wow. Yeah. You rarely see those.
Or, no, it's like 4 ounces or something. It's like.
It's usually what they give you if you get
sidecar.
If you do a flight, they'll usually give you 4 ounce glasses. Yeah. 4 ounce glasses. Or some places are actually really nice and will let you get those outside of a flight. Like a lot of the local breweries around here will do that, which is nice if you're like me. You want to go out and drink with coworkers, but you don't want to like drink a whole lot, or if you're like watching your waistline and you're like, I don't want to do a full beer because that's a huge commitment with regards to
party diet, calories. Man. Party diet with a lime to make it not taste like chemicals.
Or just, you know, just drink Guinness.
Oh my god.
I mean that's dinner right there.
Exactly.
Oh, that was hey, who remembers Al Stroger? That was his secret. The dude only drank beer, and he was in great shape.
Yeah.
Because he was, that all of his calories came from alcohol consumption.
I've joked no, about I that actually, with work colleagues, but I don't think I can get to... they don't really appreciate drinking.
I had a friend travel with me in England for a week or so several years ago, and I got him to lose something like 15 pounds in the space of a week with lots of walking and a diet that consisted of almost nothing but beef and Guinness.
I had a girlfriend who had a McDonald's diet. Whenever she gained too much weight, she would walk a mile to McDonald's, eat a cheeseburger for lunch, and walk back, and she would lose like 5 pounds in a week eating not McDonald's burgers.
I mean, you know, it's probably going to give you heart trouble eventually, but...
Well, baby steps. One problem at a time.
Yeah, you know, it's whichever is the most immediate problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Penguin Trooper asks if anyone is going to any conferences before Christmas. I personally am going to go staff Mag Labs, so Magfest Laboratories in Alexandria, which is in September, and there's going to be some really cool stuff, so if anybody wants to come to Alexandria and hang out at the March Center.
Land of Alexandria? Like Alexander the Great's?
Alexandria, Virginia, the one by Washington, D.C.
What day?
The one in Virginia.
What date?
Oh, date-wise, it is September, it should be 9th through the 11th.
I will, I'll be in Reston during that time, and somewhat available, maybe. Is it worth driving down?
So there's going to be, I think, Tool is supposed to be there, so there should be, I think, kind of a Lotsworth thing. There are probably some pretty good bands. I mean, honestly, I find it a lot of fun. But then again, I also, like, so I do it to staff, so I'm just working in the technical operations, so I'm running cable, and I don't know, I use it as an excuse to drink and hang out with people while doing stuff I don't get to do at my day job.
Right.
That's kind of what we all do.
But let's take a look. They should have like an arcade set up. The vendors last year were pretty all right. So let's see, musicians, who do we have that it's announced? Search Snake, Steel Samurai, The Yordles, Insane Ian, Chiptunes Win presents Chiptunes Challenge, Bit Brigade, Explosion Sound.
How much chiptunes you can listen to before you have to leave the room?
You Bred Raptors, Overclocked University, Flex Style, Stargate, which looks like a reggae band, if I can be completely honest, which sounds awesome.
Sound like team names for my Simpsons trivia nights.
Peer Review Review, Neskimos, and the Megas should all be there.
I don't know any of them. Probably.
They have the Gamer Iron Chef Initiative, and then MagFest Versus. So the Gamer Iron Chef Initiative...
Sounds like they're giving gamers some knives.
MagFest Laboratories is pleased to announce the return of the Gamer Iron Chef Initiative, a competitive competition centered around video gaming and designed to isolate the curious tastes and feeding habits of humans. This test will consist of three teams of three test subjects. Standard attendees, staff, dealers, panelists, and guests will all have been cleared to participate in this test so long as they've been pre-registered by the main computer cluster. The teams will be allotted 1 hour to prepare three dishes, appetizers, entree, and a dessert or beverage, using only a microwave, a blender, and a George Foreman grilling device. Teams will be permitted to procure necessary foodstuffs beforehand, with a limited reimbursement fund authorized by the logistics division. Some basic consumables and spices will also be provided, along with, of course, the secret ingredients. The teams will be rated on the categories of taste, originality, presentation, use of secret ingredient, and overall by a panel of overseers chosen in advance. Plan your dishes wisely, for only the finest will be selected. All contestants should have these other qualifications. Feel that they can represent the human taste experience to the overseers. Enjoy themselves under the scrutiny of observation. Possess excellent teamwork and time management skills. Willingness to be assessed by other overseers while being recorded for our human learning archives. Teams must be able to arrive... I think that's pretty much the exciting bits. This deadline for sign-up is September 4th.
I call this Flambe Doritos... Doritos Mountain Dew. Like, what kind of... Gamers are not exactly known for their culinary apt, but I guess...
obviously you should hang out in 2601 The Snacker Quarterly.
It's a great group. Yeah,
it's pretty good. Sure. Oh my god, I made slow cooker pulled pork today, and holy shit!
Yeah, I saw you talking about that in IRC.
There are so many pictures I need to take. It's so good. Also, I have so much fucking pulled pork. If anybody wants to come and eat some of my pulled pork,
that's sadly a vague innuendo.
I would happily do so if you were closer by, but. I've just been subsisting on beer and nachos for like the last 2 weeks.
Do you have a slow cooker?
I do not.
You should buy one. They're good for chili.
The
and...
reason why I'm subsisting on beer and nachos is because I don't have the money for anything else.
That's rough.
Yeah.
I'm very, very, very extraordinarily slowly clawing myself out of the giant financial hole that Hope put me in.
Mm.
Yeah, that reminds me, I need to pay off some credit.
That's
cards.
A thing. Yep, yep. I am going to B-Sides Delaware, B-Sides Philly, which is the first year for B-Sides Philly, and Pump
I Cotton. Thought B-Sides Philly was...
I don't know what to expect.
It was past January, wasn't it?
What?
I thought B-Sides Philly was listed as having started last January or something. Or am I mistaken?
Sorry, you're breaking up, and I'm missing like half of it.
Mm. B-Sides Philly. All
right, try again.
Okay.
Yes.
I thought that it was the
nope,
first.
Nope. Still
one...
breaking up.
You're breaking up with me?
December.
I thought there was one in January.
December 2nd to 3rd, 2016. I mean, it is possible that there's been one previously.
Maybe I'm thinking of something else. Like,
B-Sides Delaware, I think, was doing its first one last year? No.
No, I've been to B-Sides Delaware before, and it's I remember going... I remember it being super cold, so I'm almost positive it was winter. I'm pretty sure this is the first B-Sides Philly.
You know what? I think it was B-Sides New York.
Mm.
Had their first one like January or February of 2016. Because I remember my local tool chapter was asked to run a lockpick village for them. Like 2 weeks beforehand. And it was just after we had, like, the entire chapter membership had gotten the confirmation that we were all going to ShmooCon.
Oh, gosh.
Which itself was the exact same weekend as B-Sides New York. Mm-hmm. It was like, good going, guys.
Yeah.
Thanks
for the advance notice.
Yes. Good great scheduling there. You know, you made sure that you weren't running opposite any major conferences, except for that one.
Oh, holy shit.
Where we have had a presence for years.
Completely unrelated. I just saw Alex, who does the Knox stuff. Apparently ITT Tech is going to go out of business. Their website shows they're not accepting any new students. Linked article from the Wall Street Journal. U.S. government cuts off new funding for ITT Technical Institute.
Hmm.
Probably because...
Damn time.
Yeah. Holy shit. Mm. That place has been a scam for decades.
Yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah.
link for the curious.
Anybody else go? Went there for information technology, and now he is a massage therapist. Unemployed. He's actually slinging hot dogs. So.
But he says that he's a massage therapist at parties?
No, he ended up going to a state university for massage therapy. Oh. You can tell my brother is really big into falling for scams. He was also a Marine.
So. Okay. Okay, yeah.
Like, oh, I can just get a paycheck for being shot at? Fucking sign me up. So, win some, lose some. We can't all get the good genes. Okay, so I guess we'll wrap the podcast up there.
Yeah.
I guess so.
It's been... Now I feel like we should just wait the extra, like, 6 minutes and make it a full 2 hours.
Do we have a podcast title yet?
Yeah, we have a podcast title.
Yeah.
You don't remember that?
Oh.
Balls.
Party coming, business going.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Nothing about child molestation?
No. No.
Yay. Are you okay?
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, man. Who's going to Derby?
Where is DerbyCon again?
Louisville. DerbyCon is probably the best. It's right on the cusp of being too big for its own britches. But the lobby con there is amazing. It is the best con to show up to with no badge, for sure, hands down. I've never purchased a badge for it, and I have a blast. The way it's set up, the lobby con is gigantic, and the bars are outside of the con area, and everyone hangs out front, and you can have drinks outside, so everyone gets drinks at the bar, hangs out outside because the weather's beautiful at night, and like the whole party is 24 hours a day in front of the hotel or inside the lobby, where they're not allowed to badge for because it's a public area. So you can just show up to DerbyCon with no badge and have a blast. And like, if you really want to go see a talk, you can borrow a badge from somebody. So that's end of the month in Louisville. I'm riding the motorcycle down there. Oh, so we didn't answer the question of who's going to cons for the rest of the year.
Well, that's what we were discussing.
We got halfway through, and then I cut off our good friend Root.
Yeah, no, it's... I expect to finally dig myself out of this financial hole just in time to enter the financial hole of the winter holidays. So.
Good work. I'll be in, I think I go as late as November. Hackfest Canada is in November. That is a great time. Their CTF is amazing. Other than that, nothing. Everything else I'm doing is local ISSA shit. I'm waiting to hear back on KuCon in India.
What?
I got a response that my CFP was being considered. But that's in October. Like, they got to get back to me soon.
Yeah, I mean, that involves, like, immigration and stuff, doesn't it?
No, just a passport.
Just
speak for a weekend, yeah.
Yeah.
Especially if they're not paying you, if they're reimbursing you for expenses, that is different than being paid.
Well, yeah, but I mean, apparently, like England now, even speaking without any form of reimbursement requires a work visa.
So you don't tell customs that's what you're doing. I learned that in Canada.
So, you know, just as long as you perjure yourself on your immigration form.
Yep. In fact, I have to do that when entering Canada, even though they do allow it, because if you tell them you're there speaking at an industry conference, they don't understand that it's not business. Like, they just can't wrap their heads around it, that you would do anything out of your own self-interest that happens to have something to do with an industry. So you just got to be like, I'm here for fun, fucking Canada.
Well, I mean, the way I handle these conferences, that's what it would be anyway.
Right. But, like, when I like spoke at Hackfest Canada last year. They were like, "Well, we need a letter of invitation from this company that's asking you to speak there." And I'm like, "But I'm not being paid." Like it was a like I don't know. Have you guys ever been to Canada? Like customs is like just
yeah.
Always...
No, I've been to Canada.
I've been to Canada. I've had more trouble getting back in the U.S. than I've had.
Oh man, I never like. Back into the U.S.
Well, like, I was coming back in, and they were like, did you buy anything that you need? Do you have anything to declare?" I was like, "Not really, no." Like,
yeah, no.
I bought a candy bar. I ate it. And I was like, "What do you mean you don't? Like, what do you mean not really?" And then, of course, you know, my sister's boyfriend at the time, currently he's now my brother-in-law, he's Canadian, so he's got like a student visa, and he's coming back over, and then he's coming... And then, so, oh, God, it was terrible. And then
yeah,
we spent a long-ass fucking time just waiting for them. They're like, okay, you need to go park your car over here and go into this building and go up to the second story, and then you have to take a number, and then you have to sit there. I'm like, oh, my God, I have a flight. I'm so fucked. And then when they finally got it in there, it was like 5 minutes. The person's like, yeah, everything's in order. I don't know what the fuck the guy sent you up here for. If you want, there's complaint cards. We're like... let's just write that shit around right now. It's like so-and-so officer is
writing so
dick.
Angrily.
I do the global entry thing, and that's like fucking night and day. Oh, man. It's like first class versus like coach, like the way they treat you. Oh, which also happened to me, like on American Airlines, I screwed up. I was in coach, and like, cause I'm platinum, I get upgrades I can use sometimes, and so like I'd used my upgrade to get upgraded to first class, but forgot, and so like I went and sat in my normal seat on the plane, which subsequently just appeared to not have been sold after I gave it up, and like the stewardess was like just a total bitch to me, cause like I wanted some water before the plane had took off, and like took forever getting it, and gave me this fucking attitude about it. And then, like, I realized, oh, I'm supposed to be in first, and then I moved up, and then here comes that waitress again asking if I need anything, sees me, and I go, oh, yeah, sorry, I was in the wrong seat, show her my shit. And she's like, oh, no problem, Mr. Christmas. Yes, sir, Mr. Christmas. Can I get you anything? And I was like, oh, no, you've given me enough attitude for the rest of the flight. I think we'll be good. And, sorry, Mr. Christmas. And I didn't see her the rest of the time.
Probably for the best.
Yeah, but like that implies that you're trained to do that. To like the coach people like shit. And that's weird.
Well, it might not be that they're trained, they just might be an asshole and then realize that if a person in first class complains that they're an asshole, that it has more weight than if somebody in coach complained that so and so was an asshole. And I think people who pay more money for stuff are more likely to complain when shit doesn't go right.
I don't know, because most of the people in first that I come across, they're flying on their company's dime.
That's probably true, because it's very expensive to do otherwise.
Yeah.
I think if you have enough money to pay for first class, you probably aren't going to be flying first class, because you probably own a fucking plane.
Oh, no, man, that's a whole different amount of money.
Is it? Is it an order of magnitude or greater?
Yeah,
a couple orders of magnitude?
Yeah.
Is it?
Especially if you're owning a jet like that can take you across the country? Yeah.
That's probably true.
Yeah, I mean, an aircraft that you can take like a couple counties over.
What's a G6 cost?
I've never actually looked at
that. Now I've got to look that up.
Yeah, because that's like the most common.
If you do an ultralight, it's not that bad.
Ultralight,
not an ultralight. It's sport light. If you do a sport light, they're actually not that bad. But then you have to.
Is $66 million for one plane.
Gulfstream G650 list price $64.5 million.
There you go.
That's list in 2013.
It's list. So you can get a few bucks off list if you...
Actually, because of the wait list, aircraft produced for delivery in 2013 sold for more than $70 million.
There you go.
So yeah, no, you're talking.
Yeah.
You're talking several extra zeros.
Yeah, a sport light. Max speed on a sport light is like 60 miles an hour.
Really? Thought they were better.
Yeah, we're that. Not. We're not talking about little. You know, Cessna
right. Or a Piper. You're
replacing your usage of American Airlines for something you would fund privately in, like, yeah, order of magnitude. Like,
yeah.
It's $2,000 a first-class seat. Like, it would still take you over a lifetime to have spent as much as a private jet.
Including
pilots' license, you know, classes. And
oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, the staff and the...
maintenance. Yeah. So there, because I thought about doing it, and it did not work out. Are we off the air? Are we still on the air here?
It says we're still live, but I think we ate up that 6 minutes and then some.
All right. I made some bulletproof.
I never got to tell my stupid custom story.
You still can.
That's true. Beaches hasn't cut me off yet. So,
we're done!
Ah! No, yeah, so this was a number of years ago. I was going to university in England at the time, and I was coming back right after the 7/7 bombings. And I get back to JFK... and at the time, I was a very, very, very heavy smoker. And so I get out. I'm in the arrivals terminal at JFK, waiting to go through customs. And I'm dressed for a very damp beginning of August in London. And I'm now in the arrivals terminal at JFK, where it's like 90-something degrees and very humid. And I'm carrying all of my luggage for a full semester. And so I've got a raincoat, a three-piece wool suit, a felt hat, the whole thing. And I've got this customs officer giving me the stink eye and pawing through a bag that is basically 6 months' worth of dirty laundry. And saying, why do you look so nervous? Why are you sweating? Like, I've been traveling for the last 12 hours. I haven't had a cigarette for 10 of those. And I'm dressed for it to be 55 degrees and raining. And I'm in a 90-degree arrivals hall. What do you think happens?
Why are you so sweaty?
Why so serious?
Yeah.
Then who was phone? Oh, Radio yeah. Statler, video call.
Huh. Are you back, Beaches?
There who was phone, Beaches?
Oh, God. Oh, no. No, no, no. Oh, shit. It wiped the entire group chat.
Oh, well.
Oh, no.
I still have it. Can I?
I've got it.
Yeah, copy it and email it to me or something. I was going to use that to fill in the info for the video.
Oh, okay.
Give me a sec here.
Yeah, everything crapped out. I even, like, I got logged off of Slack. I think I got disconnected from IRC, which nobody would have noticed because I use ZNC, so I really just got disconnected from my ZNC bouncer.
Okay, let me know if that went through.
Yeah, there we go.
All right.
Holy shit. All right. I think that's my router telling me that it's time to get the fuck off.
Probably.
So there was also a question about what does it say on the telephone box on your calendar?
Which?
Yes. What does it say on your calendar?
Who was phone?
But who was phone? It was August, right? Yeah, so it's apparently from Greece. So this is the 2600 calendar for 2016. It's the current year. which I thought it was interesting. I think it was August 31st. As listed as 2600 editor Emmanuel Goldstein arrested with 1,200 others while reporting on Republican National Convention in New York in 2004. And also, private pictures of celebrities leaked after breach of Apple's iCloud in 2014. So, if I'm not mistaken, that is the fappening.
Yeah,
also, I believe so, yes.
iCloud.
So, yeah, if you guys have never, if nobody's ever picked one of these up, it's a good use of like $10. Or 15 or something.
Is it the 2600 calendar?
Yeah, it's just, it's the hacker calendar by 2600.
Yep.
And then
always
it's
a
just...
a lovely calendar.
Yeah, and the pictures
to,
are beautiful.
You know, advance the pages.
I heard it's in short supply, actually.
Well, it's early days yet.
Yeah.
You've got a good several months to go before you need the 2017 edition.
Yeah,
and then once 2017 gets here, this gets really cheap. I've definitely bought previous years before just to see the calendars and what other.
I mean, it usually takes a long time for 2600 to completely sell out of anything.
It's really? It's true.
I mean, aside from tickets to Hope. Which even then, I think this is the first year that they ever did.
Speaking of Hope, if anybody has the badge from, I think it was Hope 10, where it was like the police badge and it was a patch.
Oh yeah.
If anybody has extras of those that they wouldn't mind parting with.
What do you want to pretend you were?
Whatever you have dupes of. Like, I don't want to deprive you, but I want... So I have a denim jacket that I'm hoping to slim down enough to fit into, and I'm going to sew patches for everything. But I'm also going to start displaying all of my badges, like, on my wall. And I don't want to sew it on there, because then I can't display it on my wall, but then I still want to put it on, if that makes any sense.
Let's see.
It's really selfish of me. But if anyone has extras that they want to get rid of...
Let me sort through the collection here.
Oh, my gosh.
Nope, dropped a couple. Nope, dropped some more. Okay, now that's Schmoo, that's Maker Faire, that's... Okay, here's just the Hope badges. And I need to compare this to the chart. Let's see, you can be press, you can be press, or you can be an attendee.
You have two attendee badges?
Yeah. You want to be an attendee? You
I would love attendee. To. I actually don't have an attendee badge.
Okay.
So I got it. Yeah, well, I somehow finagled myself. I was like, oh, I'm part of Radio Statler. I'm staff. I'm supposed to have a staff badge.
Well, I ended up as...
They apparently took that at face value and gave me a staff badge, which I don't think I was supposed to have.
As staff, attendee, and press.
Oh, okay. So you have one of each.
Yeah, but I can happily part with the attendee.
Okay. In unrelated news, well, sort of.
I've always got this.
Oh, that's beautiful. Somebody found my Radio Statler planning notebook, and they're going to mail it to me. I'm so excited. Good. Like, I thought it was gone. I had replaced it, and I was getting ready to, like, make notes and stuff, and then somebody's like, I found, like, this obviously Radio Statler notebook while I was unpacking stuff. And whose was that? So I labeled literally everything that I brought for Radio Statler to Hope this year, except for the notebook. Like, I did all of the electronic stuff and everything, and then didn't do that one. And then that was, of course, the thing that I lost.
No. My, this one, though.
Oh, the Hope 11 crew badge. That's sweet.
So you can actually sew some of these on your jacket and stuff?
Oh, Hope X, which was 2 years ago, that was the 2014 conference, they were, the badges were iron-on patches.
Oh, okay.
Super cool.
So there you can see the backside of it, and it's got that plasticky coating that melts when you heat it up.
Yeah, I see.
It's fabric on the front.
But But if you ever, if you do actually iron it on, you should really sew it afterwards, because that
plasticky stuff never really holds.
No, it does not. It wears out so fucking fast.
Yeah. Let's see. Hope number 9 had the Hopeland security patches and the passport.
Oh yeah, the passport. I have. That's the other thing. I don't think they had bad like patches at Hope 11, did they?
Hope 11, I don't believe they had patches that year.
Which is disappointing.
It is. On the other hand, previously they've only done patches. Really outside of Hope X, Hope number 9 was the only time that they've ever done like patches, proper patches. Number 5, yeah, they had the fabric armband.
Yeah.
Which was either. Well, there have been punch cards. I've got a stack of those. If anyone wants the punch card badge from, is that H2K?
If it was, I don't have one anymore.
2K2? I don't know. I got a stack of them when I was doing some stuff for them a while ago, and I occasionally slip them to people. I've got all sorts of random junk. But Beaches, the next time you're in the neighborhood or whatever, let me remind me. I'll get you the badge.
Sure thing.
Maybe we should go off air at some point.
Yeah, I think now's probably the time.
Because we're into let's see.
We're past the 2 hour mark.
Yes.
We've
now set the record for longest ever podcast. By radio.
Bye, so this means we can have one that's like 10 minutes, and then the average is still going to be like an hour, right?
Yeah. Yeah, thereabouts.
All right. Let's call it. Good night. Good night, everybody.
Good night, all you crazy people.
Thanks for listening to us ramble. All right, and...